Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I hope everybody's had a great past week and are excited about this morning. It's beautiful outside, and happy Father's Day to all the fathers that are out there today. I'd like to welcome Reverend Paul Birch this morning. Thank you for being with us. Worship leader Jerry Smith, thank you for also being here today. And also, we're going to have a special reading today from Terry Beagle here in just a little bit. So thank you, Terry, for also being here. For those of you who are worshiping with us from home, welcome. We appreciate you being with us. Don't forget to identify yourself in your own special way. If you'd please sign the pads, the black folders there. We appreciate that also here locally with us. We also have many various ways that you can utilize our daycare here down in Shalom Square if you choose to. We have people, staff down there ready to assist you. We have a very special 96th birthday. Betty Smith is joining us from home today. That's the mother of Joe Smith and mother-in-law of Jerry Smith. So happy birthday, Betty. Announcements from my end of it. I'd like to call your attention to the bulletin. You'll see that the office will be closed this Wednesday in celebration or observance of June 19th. Both Pastor Merlin and Amanda will be out of the office, and if you need to get a hold of anybody in an emergency situation, you have an elder assigned to you, and if you want to try to get a hold of them, that would be fine. If you're unsure who that might be, Jerry Smith is the chair of the elders, and you can get a hold of her via her telephone number that's listed in our directory. Jane Jerger. I'll call on you first, and then we'll come up in order. Have you seated if you have an announcement that you'd like to give.
Hello. Good morning. We have gotten over 150 cake mixes for the soup kitchen. Thank you all for everything you've been doing with that. Keep in mind, Soup Kitchen is not just a one-time deal. Anytime you have extra soup mixes, cake mixes, I think I got started wrong. Anytime you have those things, please bring them over. We will get them over to the Soup Kitchen that same week so that they can get started with it. But because you've all done so well with that, we have a new request. I think most of us are familiar with the fact that there's going to be the big shoe giveaway next month. You know, when you get shoes, you also need socks. So what we're asking is that we help Changing Footprints reach their goal of 800. We know that 800 is a little bit crazy for us to do, but if we can help get toward that goal, it would be great. This is going to be over there because it's big and it's bulky and it should hold a lot of socks, so we can at least get started with that. But thank you very much.
Thank you, Jane. Yes, Changing Footprints will be setting up shop in the parking lot next month. What is that weekend? What's the dates on that?
July 19th and 20th.
Biggest need is children's socks. So if you want to make note of that the next time you go to the store, that might be something you want to throw in your buggy as you're going down through there. Are you ready? Come on up. Come on up. Come on.
Good morning. I'm Sue Lowry. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm Sue Lowry, Chair of Outreach. And I just want to thank
the congregation for their tremendous response for donating to the designated funds, church family assistance. It's been a blessing that we've received this extra money so that we can help anybody in the congregation that needs it for paying utilities or buying prescriptions or even a pesky tire that goes flat and they don't have the money to replace it. So if you want to continue to give, that would be awesome. But I just wanted to let you know that because of you, our church does change lives. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue. You're so very correct about that. Larry, did you have something?
Just a few announcements. Nominating committee tomorrow night at 6 o'clock. And I'm Ellen today. So reminding you that you can still sign up for the workshop next Saturday. Good food, the meal is free. Good fellowship, and looking into the history of the disciples. And also, the latest and greatest directory is available. If you need to get one, please see me after church. And if you need to sign up for this, see me after church.
Thank you, Larry. Okay, Terry Beagle is going to entertain us now, I believe, with a poem. Terry, come on up. Mike.
Good morning, and happy Father's Day. You will find in your bulletin the Father's Day poem I'm going to read. Please share it today. It's on blue paper, appropriate for fathers. What makes a dad? God took the strength of a mountain, the majesty of a tree, the warmth of a summer sun, the calm of a quiet sea, the generous soul of nature, the comforting arm of night, the wisdom of the ages, the power of the eagle's flight, the joy of a morning in spring, the faith of a mustard seed, the patience of eternity, and the depth of a family need. Then God combined these qualities. As there was nothing more to add, he knew his masterpiece was complete. He called it Dad, and the author is unknown.
Well, I believe that's all for announcements today, so we'll be complete.
Please rise in body or in spirit and join me in the call to worship. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, my soul.
I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live.
Do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save.
Blessed are those whose help is of God and Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God.
He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. He remains faithful forever. Let us sing, "This is my Father's world." Almighty Father, we come to you today to praise you, to worship you, to honor you. We ask for your Holy Spirit to speak to our hearts today and to move us into a greater understanding of your will for our lives as we sing together, pray together, hear your word, and commune together, remembering Christ's sacrificial love. In the name of Jesus, your Son, who walked among us, we pray. Amen.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you'd require. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless word, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you.
Thank you, Mark. You know it's from the heart. Please join me in the morning prayer. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, as we join in prayer this morning, help us to center our hearts and thoughts on our worship of you. We are so thankful that you, our Father, are compassionate, faithful, and unchanging. You are our refuge in this chaotic world. In your arms, we are safe and secure. As we celebrate Father's Day, we want to thank you for those special men that you have placed in our lives, those men that have poured love and grace into us, who have helped us along the way. We ask that your blessings rain abundantly on them. Although we love you, we confess that often we fail to acknowledge you in all areas of our lives. We go our own way. We get so caught up in the everyday living of our ordinary lives. We take you for granted. Yet we feel hurt and slighted when others take us for granted. Let today be our reset. Help us to make our relationship with you in spending time in your presence to be our first priority. Lord, we are a sinful people. We ask your Holy Spirit to show us where we have allowed sin to creep in and gain a foothold. Make us uncomfortable in allowing our sin to continue. Send us faithful brothers and sisters to encourage us and to help us to be accountable in walking out this Christian life. Lord, you know the joys we celebrate and the sorrows and concerns of our hearts. Some we have given voice to, but all are known by you and are laid before you. In our joys, let us celebrate, remembering it is you who have blessed us. In our concerns and sorrows, let us draw from the strength only you can provide. For those who are ill, we ask for your healing hand upon them. And for those who grieve, we ask that they feel your comforting presence and can rest in your promise of unending life in you. In this imperfect world, help us always to see the needs of others and to come alongside of them, to be your hands and feet in service to them. You have set the example. You have shown us your heart by Jesus' life and sacrifice for us. Help us to live in gratitude, sharing that love with our neighbor, and we trust you to give us correction and grace when we fall. Renew our spirits as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today's scripture reading is from Psalm 103, verses 1 through 5 and 13 through 18. Praise the Lord, my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower on the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts.
Morning, everyone. Good to be with you. My name's Paul. If I haven't met you, I know I've met many of you before. Hey, good to see you all again. And thank you for having me back. I'm really privileged to have the opportunity to share scripture with you guys this morning. If we haven't met yet, my name's Paul Birch. I grew up here in Greenfield, grew up at this church, and started a journey for me, a very important part of which was between the ages of 18 and 22. Had a very significant season in my life in which I really met God in a profound way, and so much so, for the last 40 years, I've ended up working in college ministry with a group called InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, and I work down at IU. And there, kind of what we do in InterVarsity, just if you're not familiar, is we really just help college students think about some of the most important questions in life, like, is there a God? That's a pretty important one. Is there God? And if there is, how should I relate to that God? Who is Jesus? How would I actually follow Jesus if I was to do that? Especially when culture is going really, really hard this way. How do I live a countercultural life as a Jesus follower? So there's some things we do in InterVarsity. And the other thing we really try to do is give people a taste of what authentic Christian community is like, which happens to be our topic today, the foundations of Christian community. So, don't have a lot of time, and I got a lot of stuff to get to. I'm excited about our text, excited to be with you. So if you have a Bible, or if you're on your phone, whatever, we're going to be in the book of Acts, chapter 2. So if you want to find that in your pew Bible, or your personal Bible, or your phone, that would be wonderful. But we're going to be asking the question, what are the essentials of healthy Christian churches and healthy Christian community? So it would be really fun. I wish we had time to actually have a conversation. If I were to poll you, like, what are the essentials of great Christian community? I'd be very curious what the conversations would be like, because I think we'd have some conversations like this. It's like, well, we would talk about music for sure, right? I care a lot about music, so we might have, well, gosh, do we bring in the rock band for worship? Or do we have a piano and organ? By the way, the piano and organ is awesome. It's Honey, can we buy a pipe organ and put it in the house? It's pretty awesome. But we'd have those kind of questions, right? Do we have a rock band or do we have a piano and organ? We might have, do we have a building that kind of looks like a church? Stained glass, religious symbols, or do we have a church that you could have in a strip mall and it's like an office building? We might have questions about do we go very formal and liturgical or do we be very free and very spirit-led? Now, wherever you land on those kind of questions, here's the thing. They're all externals. There's all flourishing churches that use all those traditions. What we need to do is think about what are the things that supersede those externals. They are the things that are foundational to all healthy Christian gatherings, Christian communities. That's what we want to look at today. Acts 2 will help us to do that. So let me read for you Acts chapter 2, verses 38 to 47. A little bit of background. Jesus has come. Jesus shows up and says, the kingdom of God is at hand. He can say that because Jesus is the king. And he says, the kingdom of God is at hand. And what Jesus inaugurates is a new kingdom that's characterized by love, forgiveness, reconciliation, shalom, healing. Jesus ushers into this brand new experience that God has been planning from Genesis 1:1. Right? Jesus is the king. The kingdom of God is at hand. And as we know, the Easter story, Jesus is killed, he's dead, he's buried, he's risen from the dead, as we celebrated at Easter. 50 days later, though, 120 Jesus-following people are in a room, and there's a lot of weird stuff in the Bible, here's one of them, but something very strange happens, but God shows up in a very supernatural way. We call that day Pentecost, and Pentecost is when the Holy Spirit actually comes, and not only is the Holy Spirit around and with the believers, now the Holy Spirit actually indwells Christ-following people. And Peter, who... if you know much about Peter, his life with God is like this, kind of like yours and mine. It's super up and down, right? He has good days. He has plenty of bad days too. But Peter is a changed person, and he preaches this sermon. And as we're going to see, 3,000 people begin to trust and follow Jesus. And they've just heard this sermon, and they collectively kind of are thinking and saying, now what do we do? What should we do, Peter? And this is Peter's answer. Brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. With many other words, he warned them. He pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Good church growth program they have there. 3,000 were added. And it says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together. That's the second time you've seen that word. In the temple courts, they broke bread in their homes and ate together, that's three, with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. In this passage, we're going to look at what I think are three foundational essentials for Christian communities. And as I say, they supersede buildings and musical styles and things like that. Here's the first one. A healthy, flourishing church is made up of people who are transformed by Jesus. Transformed people. If you're an outline-taking person, here's your outline. Transformed people, transforming practices, and transforming mission. Right? So we're starting with transformed people. So Peter said, repent and be baptized. And then he talks about forgiveness of sins. And he talks about being filled with the Holy Spirit. We're going to hit those four things real quick. Let's talk about one of our, a word we don't talk about a lot. It's repent. That's the first word out of Peter's mouth. We need to repent. Now, I hear repent and I think, wow, that is really going old school on me. Like I think of like kind of crazy TV preacher guy and bad haircuts and stuff like that. But repent is actually a very, very good and helpful word. It simply means to change your mind. To repent is to change your mind. It means to do a 180-degree turn in your life. So I'm going this way, and I'm leading a self-led life. I'm leading a Paul Birch-led life. I'm in charge. I am the master of my destiny, as the old 1800s poem says. I'm the master of my destiny. I'm the captain of my ship, all that kind of stuff. That's the self-led life. And I'm going this way in a self-led life. And when I repent, I turn, I change my mind. I do a 180 and I begin to live a Jesus-led life, a Christ-led life. That's what it means to repent. Secondly, out of repentance, we want to publicly say to the church and to the world, I am a Christ follower. I am aligning my life and my practice with Jesus. So Peter says, repent and be baptized. Now, there's nothing magical about the water. Nothing special about the water. However, there is something special about why we do it. And that is that in baptism, we are unified with Christ in saying this, the old self is dead and buried with Christ, and I'm raised to new life out of the water to new life with Jesus Christ. That's what baptism is. You know, there's all kind of language to describe this fresh start with God, new beginnings with God. Jesus used the terminology of new birth. That's a brand new life. It's a new birth. Paul used the language of adoption. You're being adopted into a new family. Paul also used language of going from spiritual death to spiritual life. Whatever language you use, in a healthy, flourishing church, we must have a life-changing, transformational encounter with Jesus. Repent and be baptized. That needs to be true for all of us. And as a result of that, two amazing things happen. First of all, it says we experience the forgiveness of sins. This is very, very good news because it means that no matter what your history is, doesn't matter what your past is, there is just nothing you have done or will do that puts you outside of God's love. There is nothing you can do or have done that disqualifies you from God being able to forgive you. Because Christ went to the cross, he took the penalty and punishment for sin that I deserve and that you deserve, and he, as the old song says, he paid it in full. You are forgiven. That's good news. Not only that. But God gives us, again, there's lots of weird stuff we believe as Christians. I'll just name that up front. But here's another one. The Holy Spirit comes and actually resides in you. Not a feeling, it's not an emotion, but like the Holy Spirit, God actually takes up residence in your life. That's really good news because, you know, you and I cannot live the Christian life just by wanting to alone. It's just not that easy to forgive your enemies. It's just not that easy to love people unconditionally. We need God's Spirit in us to transform us so that we become more and more and more like Jesus, which is the goal of the Christian life. The Christian life is not say a prayer so that I go to heaven in the sweet by and by. It's not less than that, but it is certainly more than that. The Christian life is the Holy Spirit comes in us and a bunch of us begin being little Jesuses in our communities and in our families. And you get animated and empowered to be and speak and act and think more and more like Jesus day by day. That's the Christian life. What a wonderful thing. So that's point number one. How are we doing? That's transformed people. That's the invitation to us. Repent, be baptized, know that you're forgiven. Be confident of that, and know also that God's Spirit resides in you. Here's the second outline point, transforming practices. Because remember we said that Jesus said, talked about a new birth? The thing is, you're not supposed to stay an infant forever. Yeah, that's right. You know, like that's not the way life works. You're born and then you actually mature and grow and become an adult and grow into fullness, right? That's not always true in our Christian experience. Sometimes we kind of like have a decades long stuck at like infanthood. We want to move forward. So here's the thing. Nobody just casually drifts into Christian maturity. No one just wakes up one day and says, wow, I just feel like worshiping God, and I feel like forgiving my enemies and loving people who are difficult and being full of grace and compassion. We just don't wake up being that person. So what we have to do is we have to engage in transforming practices so that we become more and more like that person. So here's my analogy for us. I would like, at age 63, I would like to be in reasonable shape. So I walk the dog, and sometimes I really get ambitious and I go for a jog, and some days I go upstairs and I sit on my exercise bike. But if it's hot, I don't do those things. If I'm tired, I don't do those things. I am casual about it. However, so in other words, I am not devoted to being fit. I'm not devoted to it. I'm casual about it. But my son, when he ran cross country, he would run 90 to 100 miles a week. He would get up in the at 6 in the morning and he'd run a bunch of miles, and then he'd go back again at 5 or 6 in the evening and they'd run a bunch of miles, and it didn't matter if it was 94 degrees outside. See, he and his teammates were devoted. They had actually ordered their life around becoming better runners. They had arranged their life. They had a coach. They ate differently. They had a plan for getting good. It says here, verse 42, they devoted themselves to three different practices, these Christians. They devoted themselves, and I'm going to summarize, they devoted themselves to scripture, to community, and to prayer. And I'll just say, without those three things, it is nigh unto impossible to advance in the Christian life. I will stay a spiritual infant all my life if I don't order my life around these three disciplines of scripture, community, and prayer. Let's talk about them for a second. Number one, scripture. Hey, you might know this already, but we live in a highly, highly biblically illiterate age. I know that because I have been that person. I don't know how it's possible, but it is. You can grow up in church for 18 years, and at the time I went to college, I knew there was an Old Testament and a New Testament. I knew there was a Christmas story. I knew there were four Gospels. That was the extent of my Bible knowledge. And I'm not that unusual. That is true of our culture. Friends, if we're going to know God deeply, if we're to experience what Jesus called the abundant life, we have to have a relationship with God's word. We have to order our lives around knowing scripture. And there are a million Bible plans out there. Your problem will not be finding a Bible plan. Problem might be executing it, but we all face that. But anyway, have a plan. Even this summer, maybe there's one book of the Bible, and you say, this summer, I want to be mastered by the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark. I'm going to saturate my life in the Gospel of Mark this summer so that I can know Jesus more intimately. That would be an example of devoting yourself to that. Secondly, we need to be devoted to community. The Christian life was not meant to be lived out solo. This is not a solo affair, right? Just kind of like, I'm going to go through life. It's got to be me and God, and I'm just going to plow through, and I don't need anyone else. The Christian life was meant to be an interdependent experience where I need your gifts and you need mine. I need people in my life who have more mileage with Jesus than I do, and there are people who need me because I have more mileage than they do. We are an interdependent thing. But what's not acceptable is that we would simply live the Christian life in some kind of a solo fashion. We're almost bound to fail if we try that. So we're committed to Scripture, we're devoted to community, and thirdly, we're devoted to prayer. Jesus said, apart from me, you can do nothing. So we need to be a praying people. Now, I want to say two very true things. Number one, we should pray for sick people. It's actually commanded. Like, not only did Jesus model caring for sick people, but in the book of James, it's like explicit, pray for the sick. However, second true thing, we shouldn't only pray for sick people. Like, there's lots of things to pray for, right? In fact, we just prayed the Lord's Prayer. Do you ever notice, like, you know, we do this thing every week, so, right? Do you ever notice what we actually prayed, the Lord's Prayer? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. That's an invitation to worship. It means to hallow God's name means that, God, I'm declaring that my highest allegiance is to you, my highest priority is to you, and all my obedience is deserved to you. That's what it means to hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. What does that mean? It means, God, I want your will to be done in my life in the very same way that it's done in heaven. And how is God's will done in heaven? Is God's will kind of like, you know, up and down days? No, God's will is perfectly done in heaven. So that's our prayer. God, would you operate in this world and in my life so in the same way that it's done in heaven? Basic human needs. Give us this day our daily bread. So we need finances. Yes, we need food. Yes, we need health. And finally, we prayed, lead us not into temptation. So we pray, God, help me to live a holy life. Help me to live a life that is pleasing to you. Help me to live a life that reflects something of your purity, God. So there's lots of things to pray for. That is point number two. We need to, if we're going to know God deeply, we need to give ourselves to transforming practices of Scripture, community, and prayer. Ready for number three? Here we go. Number three is simply this, transforming mission. Let me read a little bit. All the believers worked together and had everything in common. They sold property and position and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. We are a people on mission. We don't exist to simply serve ourselves. Our mission does go in two directions, though. Jesus said, go and make disciples of all the nations, teaching them to obey all that I commanded. But that mandate goes in two directions. Number one, we are called to care for this Christian community. And so as we read in here, what we see is that the early Christians practiced radical generosity. They were a group of people, they saw needs and they met needs. And they didn't simply meet needs if they had a superabundance and they wouldn't really feel it that much if they helped. They met needs with sacrificial generosity. They sold their own stuff and gave the earnings to people who had need. They were other-centered in a very radical way. As a result of that, listen, people are going to disagree with your theology. They might think that what we believe as Christians is really weird and out to lunch and outdated. But when they see us living out radical generosity, meeting needs that no one else, when we see people, you know, putting shoes on people's feet, when we see soup kitchens that are being stocked and hungry people being fed, the world is going to look and say, I don't know if I believe in their Jesus, but I'm more likely to believe in their Jesus after seeing the way they live. You have my attention. That's what happens when we live in radical generosity. So we need to do that. Secondly, though, we not only meet the needs of our own community, but we are thinking about outside of our community, including those that do not share our faith. It's not only, it's not only acceptable, it is like part of the gospel that we would reach people for Christ. So I got a couple things I want to say about this. I love this passage because it says the early church enjoyed the favor of all the people. Can you imagine in 2024 people being like this? Here are words I don't hear very often. 2024. Wow, I'm impressed by the church. Their character, their integrity, their words just bless me, and I'm more curious about Jesus because of what I see in the church. I don't think that's what we're here. But we are called to have favor with all the people. And here's our problem, I think. Two things that we need to pay attention to. Number one, if you have a friend who's not yet a Christian and they've never mentioned hypocrisy, I would be really surprised, because just our friends who are outside of the faith, they see our lapses in integrity. They do see our inconsistency where we verbally align with Jesus, but our attitudes and our just our character oftentimes just does not match up with Jesus. And so we're sending confusing messages to the world. So that's one, is we need to just pay attention to what's going on with hypocrisy. But here's one that's particularly close to my heart. I think in the church today, we are known by what we are against and not by what we are for. We're known by what we are against. Gospel means good news. In fact, just say that out loud with me. Gospel means good news. One more time. Gospel means good news. We are called to speak and be and live and model good news to the world. But I think what the world often sees in us as the church, and I'm talking big C, not necessarily Greenfield Christian Church, but what the world sees is, well, I'm against these people. I'm against this group. I'm against this political party. I'm against this political candidate. I am just against, and I'm kind of the grumpy old man saying, get off my lawn, kind of that's kind of our message to the world. Get off my lawn. That's not the way to gain favor with the world. Now listen, there's a time where the church is called to have a prophetic voice, and we're called to be salt and light. We preserve what is good. We name what is sin. And there's a time to take a stand. But when we are known primarily by what we are against, we are not modeling or proclaiming good news, because we are to be good news. And boy, I'm so glad we did Psalm 103 today, Jerry, because that's it. I think I marked it because I wanted to go back to it. I said, wow, that's how I need to end this thing today. So I'm going to. This is the good news that we have to share to the world. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Forget not all his benefits, good news. Forgives your sins, heals your diseases, redeems your life from the pit, crowns you with love and compassion, satisfies your desires with good things, and on and on and on. Jesus is good news for people. It means that we can be right with God. It means we can be reconciled with each other. It means you can have a new start no matter what your past is, and no matter how old you are, you can have a fresh start with God. So, those are my three essentials for Christian community today. Just review them really quick. Number one, transform people. And I would be amiss if I didn't say, has this been part of your experience? Repentance, baptism, knowing that you're forgiven, filled with the Holy Spirit. We need to be transformed. Secondly, are you giving yourself to the practices that transform you of Bible study, community, in prayer? And finally, do we give ourselves to in transformational ways to the mission we've been called to do? Let me pray for us. Jesus, you are good news. You're good news for me. You're good news for every person in this building. Forgive us. Forgive us for sometimes not recognizing that, and forgive us for not proclaiming that. We long to be good news to the community of Greenfield. We long to be good news to those on the margins. We long to be good news to the voiceless. We long to be good news to those who are powerful and affluent and have everything and you call us to be good news to all manner of people. So come, God, would you make us the kind of community that is modeled after this New Testament community that absolutely changed the world from 12 to 120 to 3,000, and here we are today worshiping you because of their faithfulness. Would you do something similar through us, God? And would you use these brothers and sisters in their community? And we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Table in this service. With every step, we confess again our faith in the saving grace that Jesus provided on the cross. We eat the bread and remember that he said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you." We drink the cup and remember his words, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Let us examine our lives, our thoughts, our actions, as we again prepare to come in faith to this table and gratefully celebrate the grace represented here. Come to his table prepared with love.
Lord Jesus, we come humbly, thankful that you are our Heavenly Father, that you cared for us and sent us loving earthly fathers. For them we are grateful. We ask your forgiveness for the many ways that we've fallen short and not been your servants in the ways that we should be. We ask your blessings that we may be your people here and your hands and feet in this world. As we take this cup, eat this bread, we do remember the great sacrifice you made for us. Fill our souls, Lord. Make us worthy of that sacrifice. We ask that in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
In our offering today, we have a great opportunity. Let us be of one mind and one purpose, that we will each be generous and give as we are able. By doing this, not only will great good be achieved, but we will also grow closer to the one who calls us. Your gifts are a grateful blessing to God.
Thank you.
Dear Father, we want to remember all the fathers, past and present, that are and have been in our lives, but we want to thank you for the most important one, the one who brought us here today and taught us giving, however it is more important than responsibility. It is a privilege and evidence of our faith. So we give thanks for the offering and talent to be used in your work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The invitation to belong to him is open to all. No sin is too great for him to forgive. He has already paid the price you owe for it, a price you cannot pay. He gave everything to give you more than this world could ever offer. He has given you eternal life with the Creator of the universe. If God is stirring you to commit your life to Christ, if you feel a desire to recommit your life to him, or if you would like to transfer your membership to join this congregation, you are invited to come to the table as we sing "He Touched Me." Service has concluded, but our worship continues. As we go forth, may God, who is with us, reveal himself to us, be God through us, to shine his light to the world. Amen.